upon life's billows, you are tempest tossed. When you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. Are you ever burdened with a load of care? Does the cross seem heavy you are called to bear? Count your many blessings, every doubt will fly, and you will be singing as the days go by. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. When you look at others with their lands and gold, think that Christ has promised you his wealth untold. Count your many blessings money cannot buy, your reward in heaven or your home on high. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. Thou art strong, Jesus, keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk, dear Lord, close to Thee.
Just a closer walk with thee.
Granted, Jesus is my plea.
Just a closer walk with thee.
Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. World of toil and snares. If I falter, Lord, who cares? Who with me my burden shares? Oh, none but Thee, dear Lord, none but Thee. Just a closer walk with Thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea.
Just a closer walk with Thee.
Daily walking close to Thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. My feeble life is o'er. Time for me will be no more. Guide me gently, safely o'er to Thy kingdom shore, to Thy shore. Just a close. walk with thee.
Just to go so awkwardly, just to go so awkwardly.
Granted, Jesus is my plea.
Just to go so awkwardly, just to go so
awkwardly. Daily walking close to thee. Oh, let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Oh, let it be, dear Lord, let it be.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
In you, O Lord, I take refuge. Let me never. In your righteousness, deliver me from rescue and rescue me.
Incline your ears to me and save me.
Be a rock of refuge, a strong fortress to save me.
You are my rock and my fortress.
We pray together, saying, fill us with your Holy Spirit, gracious God, so that we can know the scripture we read today be fulfilled in our hearing.
Thank you.
The proof of God's amazing love is this. While we were sinners, Christ died for us. Because we have faith in him, we dare to approach God with confidence. In faith and penitence, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been, help us amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Hear the good news. Who is in position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone. A new life has begun. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Amen.
Service for pastoral departure.
Dear colleagues in ministry, Session asked me to come here to serve as your interim pastor. The interim tasks are to help a congregation come to terms with its history, to discover a new identity, to help congregations understand that pastoral transitions often involve leaders deciding to step aside so new leaders can step forward, to rethink denominational relationships, and to help a congregation work on the task of committing to new leadership and a new future. Those tasks represent the interim side of interim pastor calling. There are also tasks, pastoral tasks, in times of joy, weddings, baptisms, confirmation, and all the informal occasions such as praying with the children, welcoming Philippa and Aaron onto staff, seeking elders to take responsibilities for work, for decisions, and offering home communion. Their pastoral responsibilities in times of sorrow, funerals, life changes, living into the goodbye you said to your former pastor, and in times of challenge. I have tried to proclaim the word faithfully among you and to serve you as pastor. I am aware of how far short I have come from what could have been accomplished. Today is my last day. I will not be in touch with you after today, so that you will be free to build a new relationship with David Euler as your supply pastor and with whoever comes to occupy the pastor's office in the future. I ask that in your love and commitment, you send me forth with a going away blessing.
Join me unto God's gracious mercy to be connected. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you.
Thank you.
Guiding God, we love to hear the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory. Teach us our part in his story so that the tired world can hear a new song.
1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 through 13. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions and hand over my body so that I may boast but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part, but when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror, dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide these three, and the greatest of these is love.
I will be reading Psalm 71, 1 through 6. In you, O Lord, I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me and rescue me. Incline your ear to me and save me. Be to me a rock of refuge, a strong fortress to save me. For you are my rock and my fortress. Rescue me, O my God, from the hand of the wicked, from the grasp of the unjust and cruel. For you, O Lord, are my hope, my trust, O Lord, from my youth. Upon you I have leaned from my birth. It was you who took me from my mother's womb. My praise is continually of you.
And the gospel lesson this morning is from the gospel according to Luke. It comes from chapter 4. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, "Is he not Joseph's son?" He said to them, "Doubtless you will quote to me this proverb, 'Doctor, cure yourself.' And you will say, 'Do here also in your hometown the things that we have heard you did at Capernaum.'" And he said to them, "Truly I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown. But the truth is, there are many widows in Israel in the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was a severe famine over all the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them, except to the widow at Zarephath in Sidon. There were also many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian." When they heard this, all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up and drove him out of town and led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now will the children please come forward? Sneak by here, please. Oh my gosh, look at that. Whew. May I see? Well, thank you. Oh my gosh, this is a picture of, look at that picture, it's wonderful. That's from Sunday school, isn't it? Is that where that is? And you all have written on there for me. Oh, that's wonderful. Can I take this and read later? Thank you so very much. That's certainly very sweet. Something else. Oh my gosh. Why, I recognize those people and those people and those people, and but I don't recognize the old guy. Thank you very much. Well, this is going to give me a way. Do you know what it's going to give me a way to do? It's going to give me a way to handle how sad I'm feeling and to handle that I'm going to miss you, because when I leave here today, do you know how I'm going to feel?
Sad.
And do you know what else I'm going to feel? I'm going to feel empty. So I know when I go home today, I will feel empty. But before I tell you, we talk any more about that, I need to say, hi, I haven't seen you in a while. It's nice to see you back. And have I met your name? Have I met you? My name is Terry. What's your name? What? Oh, nice to meet you. This is my last day, that's why I think they gave me these things as things to remember them by. And I've been saying goodbye now for 7 to 8 weeks. It's sort of like by the time I leave, people will be glad and say, thank goodness he's gone. And you have another thing?
I can piss out myself.
Well, thank you, Cash.
You can put it on your Christmas tree.
I could do that, couldn't I? Well, thank you. Okay, well, what does that rock represent, kids? That's my last day, and that means we have to take it off, doesn't it? So, would you take it off? That means that you wanted to take it off too. Well, you can take it off, and then I'll put it back, and then you can take it off too. Now we've got it off, so this is my last Sunday. And what does this pile represent?
Your memories.
It represents my memories of you. But guess what? I want to give you a memory of me. So I'm going to share my memories. Cash, there's a memory of me. And do you see? Why don't I hand them out? Do you see what's on there? What's on there? And why is there a cross on there? Why is there a cross on there? Thank you. Why is there a cross on there? Because it reminds us of Jesus. And do you know why we're all together? Why I'm here and why you're here? We're here because of Jesus. So Milo, you can take that, and if you want, you can remember me by it, and Vicky, so can you, and AJ, may I give you one? Are you giving me one, Quinn? Thank you very much. Okay, and can I just give you one? And Can I give you one? Because do you know what these have? These have my memories in them. But maybe you'll have some memories, like maybe you were here the Sunday that I tripped coming up the stairs. You're welcome. Or maybe some of you I wrote in your journals. And do you want one, Quinn?
Yes.
Let's see. There you are, Quinn. That's for you. Well, I'll just set it real close. Do you all know Olivia? Quinn is a frequent visitor to my office. Well, if some of you got heavy rocks, do you know what that represents? That represents a lot of memories.
Mine is a light rock.
Yours is a light rock? Okay. I'm sorry this is taking so long. We need to get on with worship. Quinn does bring a lot of excitement when she shows up, doesn't she?
Yeah.
And for you, Liz? No, I'm not scribbling.
He's making a cross.
You know, I'm just making a cross because I wanted everybody to have one. Do you know what a plain rock would be? It would be just a plain rock. But this is a rock to remind you that we're all here because of Jesus. And I want you to remember that. So, thank you very much for giving me things I can remember you by. Now, I need a hand. Let's see. Carissa, would you give me a hand, please? I'm going to pack my memories away. Would you pack my memories in there? That's yours. But these are my memories. Would you put those in my memory bag for me, please? Thank you. And I'm going to take my memory bag that has all of you and my memories of you wrapped up in it. I'm going to take that with me back to Colorado. So thank you for coming up and for the time we've spent praying together and the other things we've done. Can we say one more prayer?
Yes.
Okay. God, this is kind of a strange day because some people are going, like Jenny and I are going, and everybody else is staying. But that doesn't mean we can't carry each other in our hearts. We also carry you in our hearts because what lasts forever is your love. And we thank you for your love. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all very much. This is all very, very sweet.
Bye, Miss Pastor Perry.
Bye, Milo. Is that for me? The text this morning comes from 1 Corinthians 13. Probably most of us hear 1 Corinthians 13 when we go to weddings, because this is such a beautiful passage and much of it fits for weddings. But 1 Corinthians 13 wasn't written for weddings. 1 Corinthians is part of Paul's very long letter, and his letter was written to the church at Corinth, and he was writing to the church at Corinth because they were misunderstanding the Christian faith, and their misunderstandings were leading to problems in the church. Some people thought that because they were believers in Jesus Christ, they heard that all things were possible, that they were free, they could do whatever they wanted, and so their behavior became unacceptable. Paul was writing to them to say, no, you are free from sin in the world, but you want to lead a lifestyle worthy of Christ. Now, one of the things that was happening in the Corinthian church is there were some people who were saying, we have got special gifts. The Holy Spirit has blessed us in special ways. And when they said that, they were saying it to the others as if to say, we are better than you are because we've got the gift of prophecy, or we've got the gift of speaking in tongues. And when people then say that they are special, more special than everybody else, what happens is that causes divisions in the church. And so Paul writes the love chapter as part of a longer letter in which he was saying, look, what matters is not that you have this gift or that gift, because you do not understand everything yet. What you understand is that Jesus Christ came and gave his life for you. You understand that, but the rest of the mysteries of faith will be revealed to you when he comes again. Your task is to have unity in the faith. So that's what Paul was writing about. Well, the first chapter, or chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians, is pertinent to us today on the day that we install and ordain new elders. And it's pertinent because there's a passage in chapter 13 that says, love is patient. Love is patient. And so I want to talk to the two congregations I have here this morning. I want to talk to the congregation of people who have elected the elders, and I want to talk to the other congregation, the people who are the elders who will be ordained and installed. And I believe that patience is an important part of love, a gift of God's Spirit that is important as we think about installation and ordination. Let me tell you why it's important, and I can tell that, first of all, from the perspective of the congregation or the people who have elected these people to serve as elders. The story I want to tell to help you understand what your responsibility might be and what your experience might be has to do with a man who was very popular in his hometown. He was well liked at the university where he taught. He was well liked in civic organizations. He was just one of these people, you couldn't help but to like him. He was in, seemed like he didn't only know everybody, but it was almost as if he talked with everybody all the time. It was, you knew him not only by first name, but he knew everything about what was going on in your life. And so he ran for city council, and he won a seat on city council. In that community, the issue they were facing was rapid development. Many people were moving into the community, and they wanted to slow it down. So his platform was to slow down the rapid development of the community. And he was so well liked that on election night, when they reported the results, he had more than twice the number of votes than the next closest candidate. And then, of course, in that town, the city council elected the mayor. Everybody assumed he would be the mayor, but in his typical unassuming way, he said, "I am just a member of council," and he declined. So he served on council, and guess what happened? The revolution didn't occur. People had thought, because he campaigned so vigorously on a no-growth platform, that there would be a revolution and that the machines that were tearing down the hills, the developments that were sprawling way out of town and causing problems with utilities, that would all stop. But no, those things don't stop just because one wonderful person is elected to the city council. And so the revolution didn't happen. And Fred, who was this really well-liked person, soon became known as Fred the traitor, because he didn't bring the revolution. He was one of 11 votes on city council. And even though three other people with the same platform were elected, that made 4 out of 11. Growth kept happening. Fred went from the most well-liked person in town to maybe one of the least liked people in town. And he took it all into himself, and 2 years after his election, Fred was dead. Now, you can't attribute his death to what was happening, but we could see it wearing him out, and it did. His eyes became dull. He didn't have any energy. He lost touch with people. Now, from the perspective of the people who elected him, he didn't deliver on what they had hoped he would deliver on. He didn't deliver on what he'd promised. They felt as if, because the revolution didn't happen, that Fred had betrayed them. If only we could have read to the electorate Paul's letter to the church at Corinth, which says, "Love is patient." If they had have had patience with Fred, he would have been a very effective city councilman. I'm convinced he would have won enough votes on city council to have had a majority for his perspective, but somehow the message of patience didn't come. The voters wanted it, and they wanted it now. Come to think of it, don't we do that all the time? We're going through this right now. We're looking at presidential candidates. And boy, some of them look awfully smart. In the past, they've looked awfully smart and competent. But once they get into office, what happens? We often feel let down, because what they campaign on doesn't happen quickly. So the people of that town, if only they'd practiced patience. If only we would practice patience with our Congress and our president. So remember, congregation, that the people you have elected need your patience to do their best. Now, to speak to the other congregation, and that's to the elders and to the who will be ordained and installed, you need patience too. You need patience too. You need that gift of God's Spirit. You need to realize that you cannot produce quickly, because there's such a steep learning curve to learn everything about this congregation and how it runs and all the ins and outs. Be patient with yourself. You need to be patient with the fact that you will probably make lots of mistakes. You need to be patient with the fact that people are going to want your ear and won't understand why you don't seem to be listening.
There was once a candidate for an office who said, I was a smart person until I got elected, but a couple weeks after I got elected, I became one of the stupid people. And everybody who elected me suddenly became smarter than I was. And now, as an elected person, I had more information than they had, and I could see the complexities, but they had the answers. Be patient with yourself, because the job you're going into will be complex, and you're going to get lots of information. So if people who elect and people who are elected, if people like you who are the ones who were the voice of God to call these elders to serve, and those of you who are now going to be serving, will be patient with each other, willing to listen, willing to suspend judgment, there's a great promise for you. Let me give a concrete illustration of what patience means. Somebody in this congregation brought a hoverboard to the congregational dinner. If you don't know what a hoverboard is, it's a suicide machine. It's just a piece. It looks like a scooter, only you stand on it and you don't push. You lean forward or backwards or to the side and it turns you around. Or you can go forward or backwards. And so Trey said to me, would you like to try it? And of course I wanted to try it. So I got up on this hoverboard. But he was pretty smart. He asked me right out there where there was a carpet for me to fall on. But the key thing that he did was when I tried to stand up, I put my hand on him, and then he grabbed my arm, and he held me. And he was patient with me as I slowly leaned forward going down that aisle. That's patience. Your elders are going to be on a hoverboard. But if you hold on to them, and if you're patient with them, the prize is that maybe God's word for you and God's will for this congregation will become clearer. The scripture lesson says, love is patient. Today and tomorrow, this word can be fulfilled in your presence. Amen.
Whose term of session that has ended. Will the following please come forward? Jessica Decker, Sharon Hoban, Donald Mallory, Joseph Thompson, Tanya Zahn, and Kurt Zimmerman, and Virginia Kerr.
Elders, your term on session comes to an end today, but you will still be ordained ruling elders, and your call to serve Jesus Christ never ends. Will you join me in the next part? We thank you for your service, for the many hours you have spent serving on session, for the decisions you have made, the dilemmas you have confronted, and acknowledge that we could have given you more support. God bless you and keep you. Kurt, thank you for your service. Don, thank you for your service. Joe, thank you for your service. Jessica, thank you for your service. Dee Dee, thank you for your service. Now will you stand here? And on that side.
We now celebrate the ordination and installation of new ruling elders. Will Rhonda Clark, Clifford Trevan, and Rose Nystrom come forward to be ordained as ruling elders?
We have constitutional questions to put to you, but before we do, let's invite the elders to be installed to come to.
Will Gil Billick, Barbara Fry, and Sandra Smith come forward to be installed as elders?
Let's see, CJ, you belong. And these constitutional questions actually need to be answered by all of you. Do you trust in Jesus Christ, your Savior, acknowledging him Lord of all and head of the church, and through him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? If you do, say, I do.
I do.
Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable exposition of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God? If so, answer, I do, and I will.
Will you fulfill your ministry in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? If so, answer, I will.
I will.
Will you be governed by our church's polity, and will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? If so, answer, I will.
I will.
Will you, in your own life, seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? If so, answer, I will.
I will.
Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
Will you pray for and seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? If so, answer, I will.
I will.
Will you be a faithful ruling elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in government and discipline, serving in councils of the church, and in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? If so, answer, I will.
I will.
Do you want to be addressed in this as Clifford?
Do we, the members of the church, accept Gail Billig, Rhonda Clark, Barbara Fry, Clifford Kirvan, Rose Nystrom, and Sandra Smith as ruling elders, chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ? If so, answer, we do.
We do.
Do we agree to pray for them, to encourage them, to respect their decisions, and to follow as they guide us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is head of this church? If so, answer, we do.
And now we come to the laying on of hands for those to be ordained. Those who are able are welcome to kneel. That's okay. And then I invite all the current and past elders who wish to come forward for the laying on of hands. Let us pray. Guiding God, you call people into particular forms of service. You have called Rhonda, Clifford, Rose, Sandy, Barb, and Gail through the voice of this congregation to serve you as ruling elders. Guide them in this service to embody your love by being patient with themselves individually, together as a session, and with the congregation they serve. Mark them with a spirit of kindness, humility, forgiveness, intelligence, and imagination as they pray together and strive to discern your will for this congregation. Give them courage to trust their decisions. Remind them that the best any of us can do is like seeing through a glass darkly. Forgive their errors, treasure their efforts, bless their families for giving up some of their time together so that they can answer your call to this service. Make these ruling elders recipients of love, concern, empathy, and understanding from the people they serve. Let your spirit sweep over this service of ordination and installation, filling all with hope for the coming of your kingdom. Through Christ we pray, amen. Please stand. You are now ruling elders in the Church of Jesus Christ and for this congregation. Whatever you do in word and deed, do everything in the name of our Lord Jesus, giving thanks to the Father through him. Amen. Rose, welcome to this ministry. Rhonda, welcome to this ministry. CJ, welcome to this ministry. Barb, welcome to this ministry. Gail, welcome to this ministry. Sandy, welcome to this ministry. Thank you. And now we join hearts as a people praying to our God and our Savior. Gracious God, you've given us gifts of your Spirit. Help us, but all people, to practice them. Give us the courage to be patient. Give leaders the wisdom to listen. Give those with power the insight to govern with rather than over. God, embrace and mend the fear of those couples who live in countries that worry about Zika fever. We pray that if it does in fact cause birth defects, that the scientists will use the gifts you've given them to quickly find a solution. God, there are people who are trying to gather their lives together. Some fleeing war. Some still contending with bad weather. Others just because life goes on. Being old, God, is a time of trying to gather your things together to keep your body and mind in shape. Embrace all that we pray for, that we may find wholeness and healing in your word, in your presence, and in your Spirit. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We respond to God's grace and steadfast love by bringing our monetary offering and our lives to be dedicated to God's service.
At last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, as a wondrous attraction for me, for the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross to my trophies at last I lay down. Then he'll call on someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross to my trophies at last I lay down.
Please pray with me. God of steadfast love, we bring our offering and our lives in gratitude for your acceptance, love, and presence in our lives. Use this money for divine purposes and mold us into stewards of your love and word. Amen.
Thank you.
technically, worship begins with the first sound of the organ or the folk ensemble, and it ends when the organ is done playing. Would you join me today after the blessing in returning to your seats to hear Philippa's gift from God and that part of the service before we leave? Thank you. Now, be a patient people, because patience is a sign that we believe God's got God's own clock for doing things. Now, may the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord be gracious and kind to you. May the Lord's face be upon you and grant you peace. Amen.